probably the name of one religious leader that you have heard more than any other. I'm talking about a man named Joel Osteen. Joel Osteen is the lead pastor at Lakewood Church in Houston, an extremely large church in a city of very large churches. Joel Osteen and his church got a lot of attention, got a lot of press in the days and weeks after Hurricane Harvey hit the city of Houston because of their response, or really their lack of response to the hurricane. People criticized them because they had this great, big, huge, well-appointed facility and they refused to open it up to offer shelter to the people of Houston. And what made it worse was the way in which their excuses for failing to do so changed over those days and weeks following the hurricane. See, at first they said that they couldn't open the building because it was inaccessible due to flooding. But then people started posting pictures of the building. It was quite accessible, and so they had to change their excuses. And they said, well, we didn't do it because nobody asked us to. When, of course, lots of other businesses and religious organizations had thrown open their doors without needing to be asked. So, a lot of people were talking about criticizing Joel Osteen and Lakewood Church. Now, my purpose in bringing up that whole story is not really to pile on Lakewood Church or criticize someone who's maybe a bit down. I don't think they really did respond in that crisis situation as they should have, but of course it was a crisis situation. And I don't think any of us really knows how well we would respond in that situation. With all humility, I would say, yeah, maybe I wouldn't get it right either. And I do kind of understand maybe some of their concerns about their building, their property, about liability, even if I don't think they dealt with it in the right way. Now, I'm not interested in piling on or anything like that. But I would like to talk at least a little bit about some of the underlying theology, some of the underlying philosophy that was behind some of their actions and decisions that I do have some issues with. You see, Joel Osteen preaches a very particular kind of Christian message, often called the prosperity gospel. Though whether it really is a Christian message, I'm not entirely sure. Because the message of this prosperity gospel is basically this: God wants you to be rich. And I mean that literally. God wants you to be wealthy. God wants to give you lots and lots of stuff. That is the message that Joel Osteen preaches week in and week out. And I have some problems with that as a Christian message. For one thing, it seems to contradict a whole lot of the things that Jesus said. Anybody remember the time when Jesus said, "Blessed are you who are poor"? I do. It doesn't really seem to fit with a prosperity gospel. The other problem I have with this message is how it can ultimately become very abusive in the way it is applied. You see, what they do in a prosperity gospel type church is they take passages, like the one we read this morning from 2 Corinthians. The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. They take passages like that and say that the way you switch on the prosperity, the wealth that God wants to give you, is by giving generously to the church. And so they really encourage people to give lots and lots and lots of money to the church with the promise that they will personally get very rich. And then when it doesn't quite work out like that, when the millions don't just materialize for people, the people are made to feel, well, it must be your own fault. You must have lacked in faith. You must not have given generously enough to switch on that prosperity. And so you just need to give more. And so they give more, and the cycle goes on and on until eventually somebody ends up with $40 million, which is Joel Osteen's estimated net worth. And a whole lot of people end up a fair bit poorer and begin to feel like they deserve it. So it can be rather abusive. I have problems with this prosperity gospel. I understand, though, why it's popular. I understand why this kind of gospel is attractive and why churches like Lakewood have grown so large. I mean, who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want to be told week after week that God loves you and wants to show that by giving you lots and lots of cold, hard cash? That's a pretty pleasant message. It's also a pretty pleasant message when you actually have a fair bit of wealth, when you are already rich, or you're living in a situation where great wealth seems like it's possible. You know, when you're living in a city like Houston, Texas, a month ago, that's a pretty attractive message because it makes you think, well, if I've got things, if I am wealthy and comfortable in this world, it must be because I deserve it. I deserve it because of my faithfulness, because of my righteousness. So I can just lean back and enjoy it. Who doesn't want that kind of affirmation? So it works pretty well. It's an attractive message. It pulls people in. It works really well, I think, when things are good. But when things aren't so good, when the world falls apart, where you lose everything, where you don't know where you're going to be tomorrow, or what's going on, and you may never get your life back the way you needed it before. In the aftermath of a major hurricane, for example, that prosperity gospel starts to sound pretty hollow, pretty empty, pretty quick. So I'm not all that surprised that Lakewood Church, that Joel Osteen have gone through a bit of a rough patch in the last few weeks. Though honestly, I'm not at all worried for Joel. I'm sure he's going to land on his feet. I'm sure he's going to be just fine. But it raises the issue. In times like these times where we find ourselves living, what is our message supposed to be? Because I don't know how you're feeling, but I am feeling over the past few weeks as if the world is reminding us just how dangerous a place it can be. We have been reminded by Harvey, by Irma. We will possibly soon be reminded again by Jose and others. This is a dangerous world. A world where things can go very wrong. We have seen over the past month or so massive fires that have destroyed huge swaths in Canada and the United States. And then throw in on top of that a major earthquake in Mexico. And the impacts that has had. The world's reminding us that it's a scary place, a dangerous place. And honestly, for me, even all of those natural disasters that are piling up in our own minds, they're not even the worst part. I'm even more disturbed by the human-caused disasters, directly human-caused, that we're seeing. You know, when I see the resurgence of racism and white nationalism and even Nazism in our midst and society around us, that one shakes me to the core. I wonder what's going on in our world. It's a disturbing place these days. And when the world is disturbing, what message do we give? What message can we offer? And all the more these days, a prosperity kind of message where you're encouraged to just think of yourself and look for God to give you wealth and riches and everything to make you comfortable, when there are people out there who are dying, who are losing everything, who have lost their livelihood, their homes, who don't know how they're going to get it back, to start to talk about how God should make it a priority to make you rich seems petty and self-centered and the contrary message of the Christian gospel. So it's no time for that. We need another message. What can we say to the world in such a time? Well, I would turn something to apocalypticism. You know, the message of judgment, the message, oh, this is the end of the world, this is God passing our judgment on the world. I'm hearing a lot of that. Even my daughters, they tell me that that's what their friends at school are talking about. They're talking about the end of the world when they look around at what's going on. Is this the message we need to be talking about at such a time? It is tempting. And I'm hearing it from different sides, from all over the place. You know, it's coming from the left. People are saying, well, you know, these extreme weather events, you know, the heat causing the fires, the heat causing the hurricanes, you know, we're at fault for that. The way we live has contributed to the temperature of the oceans that feeds those hurricanes. It's on us. This is consequences for what we have done. This is judgment against us. I'm hearing that message in various words coming at us from various sides. And then there are others who say, well, these disasters are really God judging our society for immorality. And usually the ones who are saying that are convinced that God is upset at the very particular kind of immorality that they themselves are concerned with. And I hear that message all over the place. When I look at the unrest that we see around white supremacy and racism, I hear some people saying, well, this is payback for our failure to deal with the sins of the past. It's on us. And then from others I hear, well, this is because we're pushing too fast, too quickly in the present, and that's what's causing all of this unrest. And so, you know, again and again from every side we're hearing, well, this is just judgment, this is just the end of the world, whatever that looks like. And that's the message we need to be preaching. And I will admit that I am somewhat sympathetic to this whole apocalyptic approach, this judgment time approach to what's going on in our world. I mean, honestly, at this time, if the things that are going on in our world today could wake us all up as a society, at least a little bit, to the very thought, the fact that there are consequences to our actions and our failure to act, and if we could find in these disasters some reason to think beyond our own self-centered need to take care of our latest whim, to start thinking more long-term, that would be good. We could learn a few things along those lines. But at the same time, all of this apocalyptic thought and judgment talk, for me, is really not respectful to God. Because I'll tell you something, the God that I know, the God that I have come to know and love through Jesus Christ, does not delight in the suffering and pain of his people. Does not delight when he sees people losing their homes or their livelihoods, having their life fall apart. The God that I know knows nothing but sorrow when he sees people lost in the devastation that has been visited upon them. God does nothing but weep for those who have lost livelihoods or loved ones or homes. God doesn't want any of this. God never has. And to speak of things in that way is to totally, twist the gospel and make it say something else. So I don't think really that an apocalyptic message is the way to go. We need another approach. Not the prosperity gospel, not judgment and apocalypticism. I would go with the message that we receive from Jesus today. One of his simplest parables. The kingdom of God, he said, is if someone were to scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. In this passage, what Jesus is talking about is the kingdom of God. Jesus loved to talk about the kingdom of God. He talked about it all the time. And for Jesus, the kingdom of God was ultimately, I believe, about what God's will is for this world, what God's good desire is for this world. I know that people often assume, when they hear those words, the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, that the kingdom of God is all about another world, about what comes after death. But if you look closely at everything that Jesus said on the topic of the kingdom of God, you will see again and again that he's talking about this world and what God desires for this world. Yes, the kingdom of God may well continue even beyond death, but it starts here. And it's here that you have to find it, and it's here you have to enter it, and it's here that you live as a citizen to it. Jesus called it the kingdom of God because that word kingdom was key. He was holding up the kingdom of God as a counterexample to the kingdoms of this world, such as the kingdom of Herod in Galilee. He was saying, this is God's different way for this world. And yes, it might continue beyond this world, but it is for here and now. So that's what Jesus is talking about, the kingdom of God in this passage. And the point he's making is simply this. The kingdom of God is up to God. It's what God does. It's something that God does. We don't make it happen. We can't make it happen. God does. But we can participate in it. We are given the privilege of being part of it. So what does that mean? As you look around at the world and all the things that are going on wrong with the world. As you look at disasters, as things go wrong, the first thing it means is this. You don't have to carry it. You don't have to take on your back and carry the weight of all that is wrong in this world. It doesn't really accomplish anything. Leave that to God. But what you can do, Jesus said, is plant some seeds. Plant some seeds. You know, for example, talking about racism in our society, when you see evidence of racism, when you see people being disrespected, mistreated, even attacked, hurt, because of the color of their skin, because of their faith, because of their background, don't attempt to load on yourself all of the guilt. Past errors, for things that have gone wrong in the past, don't attempt to carry that all yourself. But what you can do is plant a seed. What you can do is to act in the moment. Stand up for what's right, stand up against what is wrong. I know that's hard to do. I know all of us would hesitate, but it is a seed you can plant. A seed for a better world. And when you see, as we see again and again in our world, the foolish thinking that dominates in this world, when you see people going on with their lives without giving any thought of the long-term consequences of their actions or their failure to act, when you see people acting, thinking only of their selfish interests and not of the impacts they have on other people or on the world or on the environment, you don't have to care. You don't have to take it on yourself to make them change their mind or their way of thinking about life. But you can plant some seeds. You can Live out a different example. You can decide to change your own priorities and the way you live in this world differently. You can support policies, government policies, other policies that make it possible for people to live differently, that make it affordable for people of lesser means to live differently. You can sow some seeds. Why do that? Well, this is the incredible promise that we have from Jesus. When we do that, when we sow some seeds, God takes it from there. This is how he puts it. He sows the seeds, he would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. Now Jesus is speaking to the ignorance of his own time, where people really didn't quite understand how it worked, how seeds actually sprouted and grew. We, as modern people, we understand a little bit more about how that actually works. But the point he's saying is this. It doesn't matter if you understand. It doesn't matter if you understand how the seed grows. The seed just grows. In the same way, it doesn't matter if you know how the kingdom of God grows up among us and in this world. You just got to sow the seed. As you go out there and sow the seeds, what you can do is trust God, that God will cause the growth, that God will cause that kingdom of God to flourish among us. And that, I believe, is ultimately the hope that we have and that we can share with our world. Shall we take a few moments in silence?